Hey, brothers and sisters, this is Brother Patrick, your absolutely most favorite brother from another mother, and I'm wearing my orange shirt, my orange sweatshirt. Hey, I washed it, don't worry about it. And I even forgot to show I've got an orange coffee mug here. You know, I don't know if I'm the great pumpkin or a big leaf or what, but I'll tell you the truth, brothers and sisters, I wore it just to be kind of contrary, because you know, the whole premise of this show we're getting ready to do, myself and Brother Sid, is the fact that, you know, we gotta be open to be truth seekers, really. And brothers and sisters, those of you who've been watching my videos for a long time, you know that I always say that I'm a truth seeker. And when you're talking about the Lord and what's right, when I had went to church as a child and went to the altar and got saved as a young person, and then I was a backslider as a young adult, and then when I came back to the Lord, brothers and sisters, when the Lord called me back to Him and told me He wanted me to preach, I questioned everything. I didn't say, well, you know, my family's Baptist, they use a King James only Bible, and they only sing the hymnals, and that's right, and everything else is wrong. No, I didn't do that. I said, I want to find out if the Catholics are right, the Presbyterians, the Methodists, or an NIV Bible, or what, you know. So I went to all those different churches and read the Bible and studied it out, brothers and sisters. So, you know, every topic is the same way. You know, the problem in the world, especially in the Western world, I think, especially in America and Europe, we're so naive, brothers and sisters. I mean, think about what happened in Nazi Germany. The people just believed whatever the government told them. Look at the Kennedy assassination, the assassination of President Kennedy. There are tons of people, I think it's 60 or 70% of people who now, today, after 50 years plus, who believe it's a conspiracy. But at the time, you know, only a few people did. And there's a famous saying, and maybe Brother Sid knows it. I'll introduce him in a second. But there's a famous saying that it's like the people that speak the truth today are bad. And then, you know, later on, it's one of our founding fathers in America said it. I think it's like to speak truth when it's a revolutionary idea is dangerous, but to speak truth when everybody agrees with it, well, you know, that's no big deal. I'm paraphrasing it there. And so to speak truth in a time when everything is going in a different direction, brothers and sisters, takes a lot of faith and a lot of guts. And that's what's missing in the world today. In these last days, brothers and sisters, from all of the things that the government has done to us and through the social media, through the chemtrails and all those things that's been going on, people and television, people have just become so more zombified by the government than ever before. And people are much more weak because of technology. You know, we have, you know, it used to be 200 years ago what made men able to stay in that leadership position was because, you know, the physical labor required to hook up the horses and plow the field and the violence in the world. There's no policemen and all that, and you had to go out and, you know, travel, and they used to have these highwaymen and, you know, highway people that would rob you and all this stuff. And so you needed to have strong men to go forward. And in the modern technology, when we have air conditioning and we have cars and the tires don't go flat like they used to, and all of this technology, it's made us soft and made us more reliant on technology, more reliant on the government. And so Brother Sid and I have been talking for a long time and looking at being truth seekers and bringing out different topics, brothers and sisters, to, you know, to question what we've been told by the government. And we have been looking at and talking about topics that are related. That's the moon landing and the shape of the earth, what's really out there, what does the Bible say about the shape of the earth and about the universe. And so therefore we started this a series of, you know, asking the right questions and seeking truth. And this first show is about, is the earth flat or is the earth a spherical ball? And so I would introduce Brother Sid. Brother Sid is from down there. We spent time together down when I was in South Carolina. And we've been talking for several years now, 3 or 4 years now at least. And Brother Sid was the one who was handling my mail last year when I was in the Philippines, when people sent stuff to me or they needed, were trying to get oil or books. Brother Sid was handling it for me last year. And so now Brother Sid is on here with me for the first time. And we've been talking about doing a radio show for two or three years, at least 3 years. As a matter of fact, Brother Sid is the one who's had the idea that we would do it three or four years ago. And so by the grace of God, this will be our first dabble into it a little bit. So I invite Brother Sid to say whatever he wants to say, introduce himself. We'll try to get into the topic.
Hey, brother, how you doing tonight? Everything's wonderful here in South Carolina. It's nice and cool and crisp, and leaves are changing, and everything looks great down here.
Great. Amen.
You know, I'm kind of a lot like you. I did a lot of thinking and researching. I was raised really strictly Southern Baptist here in the South. I'm from North Carolina, so I was raised in a very strict home, fell away from the church. But when I came back years ago, I'm just like you. I researched. I thought. I looked. For a while, I thought I was a Seventh-day Adventist. I was all kinds of different religions till I realized that I'm a disciple of Jesus, and that's kind of what I am. I don't know that there's any better definition that anybody can bring to the table. That you're just looking for the truth in the Bible, or even in the earth and what you see. And I think that from the very beginning, as a child, when you're first introduced into the world and on TV, and then when you go to school, all you've ever seen is a globe. You've never been seen anything else, taught anything else, and therefore it's just accepted that the world is a spinning ball, that we're just some little infinitesimal dot in some great expanding universe, and therefore you're insignificant.
Right.
Well, brothers and sisters, I'm not sure that I believe that. I don't want to say that I take this from a Christian point of view, but there are some things in the Bible, and Brother Patrick's going to bring that out. There are some things that I take from people who are just researchers that look at this and develop information and look at the math that NASA gives and the math that you've been taught, and a lot of this stuff just doesn't seem to work out exactly as it should in the things that we see. I think one person said it best, is possibly the best lie ever told is right in front of your eyes.
Right.
So I'll let Brother Patrick, he's got a verse or two of scripture. I think it's always best to look at it from a biblical perspective first and see, you know, what does the Bible say about it, brother?
Well, you know, there's so many verses. There's I want to give a list of verses that say basically the same thing. At one point, it says, "He has fixed the earth firm and immovable." Thou hast fixed earth immovable and firm. He has fixed the earth firm and immovable. Thou didst fix the earth on its foundation, and so that it never can be shaken. He made the earth and fashioned it, and himself fixed it fast. Now, those portions of verses I just read, I will give you the Bible verses. 1 Chronicles 16:30, Psalm 93:1, Psalm 96:10, Psalm 104:5, Isaiah 45:10. Now, that was just a few that basically say the same thing. And the Bible says, let everything be established by two or more witnesses. So what we just looked at was four witnesses that does talk about one little part. Let's look at something else. There's so many other scriptures. You know, it's even that scientist people and atheist people, they use Bible verses and say, hey, the Bible is teaching that the earth is flat, so the Bible is wrong based off of science. And what I'm saying is I, from my observation, what I read, the Bible is not written as a scientific book. The purpose of the Bible is not to lay out scientific rules. Number one, I want to say that. Number two, the Bible seems to insinuate that the earth is not moving and that the sun is going around the earth, that the center of the universe is the earth. And I want to say this too. Now, when you look at the ancient mystery religions, those of you who have watched my videos, I've talked about the ancient mystery religions. And we look back, and many people know this. Now, Egypt, because I haven't researched tonight, I'm trying to do this from memory. But now Egypt The word Egypt is like the creation mound, the word, the ancient name of Egypt. And I'm trying to think of what it is right now. But the pyramid is supposed to represent that ancient creation mound. And what, you know, and this is from the, you know, from the enemy, from the devil. And so what did, most people do know this. What did the ancient Egyptians worship? What were they told that was their God? They were told that the sun was their God. And so we can say this too, that the devil's plan and the New World Order's plan and the plans of the Antichrist is to say that the sun is the greatest thing in the whole universe and to worship the sun. And that's what the ancient Egyptians did, and that's what all of these ancient mystery religions and all that, they all point to the sun, even Masonry and Freemasonry. As you guys know, if you've watched my videos, I used to be in the Masons. My father was a Mason, and I had joined the Masons because my dad was. And you know, when I became a Christian and came back to the Lord, I stopped being involved because the Lord, you know, and I didn't even think about it. The Lord told me that it was evil, and I still didn't know why at that time until recently, you know, in the last 5 or 10 years as I've researched it. Now I know why it's evil. At the time the Lord told me that in 2000, I didn't even ask him why. I just believed him because he told me it was evil and told me to have no part of it. And so I did. And so what they point to, it's always about, you know, the east, the rising of the sun, the Sphinx faces toward the east, the rising of the sun. And so the devil's thing is to get the worship on and the, you know, the greatness of the creation being the sun. And so we need to also consider that. If the devil thinks that we ought to do something, that should be a clue that maybe it's not right. I want to say that.
Let me add that they're not worshiping the S-O-N. They're worshiping the S-U-N.
All right,
as brother Patrick is pointing out. And let me put a disclaimer, since I don't want everybody to go off the deep end here on comments or anything. You know, we're not saying that we're experts in this field. We're just starting. You know, you look at things and ask simple questions like, if the Earth and the Moon are the same size, but one's 93 million miles away and one's 276,000. Miles away, or 236, whatever, whoever's math you use. How do they make that work, really and truly? I mean, you know that that's just, we have no way of measuring that. That there's no way to measure 93 million miles. We don't have a calculator. We can't shoot a laser 93 million miles, I don't think, and calculate it back. And even if we can, if the universe is expanding forever, it just, some things just don't make any sense, brother. And I just always want to go to myself, hey, what's up with that? And my thing is, can anybody show me any experiment anywhere where you can take a spinning ball, a ball now, take a ball, just a regular ball, beach ball, basketball, I don't care what kind of ball you use, and get some water and get it to cling to that ball no matter how fast you spin it. It's going to fly right off. It just doesn't. Water will always find its lowest point.
Right, you
at
know,
a lowest point on a ball, there's no lowest point on a ball except off.
You have centrifugal forces thing out. Things out.
Even if there's such thing as gravity, it would just fall to the bottom, right?
Right, right. Well, you know, that's the thing about it. There's so many millions of different angles, dozens of angles we could come at. Like the one we were talking about earlier, one of the best points I've heard is the fact that they say, what we've been programmed to believe is that the moon, the gravitational pressure of the moon causes the tides in the ocean. Okay? And Brother Sid and I were talking about that. The Earth is 6 times greater mass than the moon, and that's why they claim if you go to the moon, like the astronauts are bouncing around in those videos, it's supposed to be from the moon, because the gravity is 6 times greater on Earth than it is on the moon. So the question is if the moon's gravity can affect the Earth to make the oceans have a tide, how come it is that the Earth is not affecting the moon 6 times greater? And what the result should be, mathematically, is that the moon would be sucked into our tractor beam, like in Star Wars or something. It would pull the moon in and it would crash into the Earth. But we don't see that. And
Brother, that's why they use the sun. They talk about the magnetic pull of the sun, how strong it is. That's why they pushed it out 93 million miles so we wouldn't get pulled into it.
right.
And you know that our orbits, you know, we come closer, you know, at some point we get so close to it, we should be sucked into the sun ourselves, because if that magical force they call gravity, and that's just magic now, those numbers are just magical. I'm like you, why won't the moon come on down?
Right. You know, we're just touching on this, and I just want to say this again. What we already talked about, it's so funny that if you walk down the street now, for one thing, you're talking about non-believers, of course. You know that they are looking at their God as science, but you can walk down the street. I know this because I actually did an experiment with some of my relatives yesterday, and I was just I said it as a joke, but I was really serious. I told him, I said, well, you know, I just want to give you one piece of information you probably never heard before. The earth is flat. Now, I didn't know what they would say, because I started smiling and stuff. But what happened, brothers and sisters, to my amazement, they got crazy. They got crazy on me. And it's just so funny that they're not scientists. They're just regular people. They became totally militantly angry because I made that suggestion. And that, brothers and sisters, is very scary to see the programming, even if the earth was round. You know, because when they got angry and they said, oh, what are you talking about? The earth is round and we orbit around the sun. And I said, well, how do you know? How do you know? Have you been in space? Did you orbit the earth?
Only what you've been told.
Right. And then they got angry because I said, well, that's just what you've been told. And then people just retreat into this sticking their head in the sand, and it's just so silly, brothers and sisters. And that's really why I wanted to do these videos, because I want people to be shattered out of their security and the things that they've been told by this world, and because everything that the world tells us is at best partially true and perverted and twisted and seen through the bottom of a dirty glass, not a clear glass but a dirty glass. Anything you can think of. So people who put such faith in the things they've been told by the world, but yet if I said, by the stripes of Jesus, you are healed, believe that you're healed and receive it. But some reason we have trouble to believe that. But yet if the world tells us something, we just, oh, they went to the moon in 1969. Okay, let's drink some Tang and talk about it. You know, I mean, all right, Brother Sid, I got on a little bit of a kick on that.
You know, NASA, you know, we're supposed to get all our information from NASA.
Right.
And I think you should look at NASA and you should look at their emblem and you should wonder why they use a forked snake tongue, you know, across their emblem as their, you know, as their serpent image there.
That's true.
To kind of understand who they are and who they worship. And you got to remember that they need billions of dollars a year for their budget. So for them, they have to prove these things out. If you guys have ever watched a rocket launch or a shuttle or anything else, you'll see it going vertically up, and then it starts breaking and starts arcing off, and it starts heading off in a different direction. It never goes straight up, and if it goes straight up, they never show you the video. When we went to the moon, all those tapes are lost. Wow. You see, now they say the Van Allen belts, nothing can get through the Van Allen belts until we explore them. This is a recent video of NASA. Their scientists say, you know, we got to do something about our equipment because it would all burn up and pass them through the Van Allen belts. And I'm like, well, we got stuff on Mars, on the moon, you know.
That's right.
We've got stuff everywhere. They contradict themselves constantly. So the point is to question things. And bring yourself into a mindset of, if one thing's a lie, what if everything's a lie?
Right. That Van Allen belt is a kicker. That's probably one of the biggest things about the moon landing and all that, is that Van Allen belt. You know, the radiation would kill you. Isn't that right? Isn't that what they say?
Yeah, it's so severe that everything would just burn up. Their instruments, everything. Talk about their instrumentation and all, how they would have to shield it, that we don't have anything to shield that, you know, their instruments and all, and they're working on that. Now, this is a NASA video where they're working on it, and I can't quote the video. I could find it if somebody's really that
They can Google it.
That hard up. Yeah, you can Google Van Allen belt, you know, NASA and the Van Allen belt, and I'm sure that it'll come up. And one of their scientists, you know, says, you know, much research has to be done before we can pass through the Van Allen belt. And I'm thinking, how many moon landings were there? Six? Seven?
Something like that. You know, they were all during the Nixon administration, too. You know, people can also Google Stanley Kubrick, and his widow is on video saying that her husband had just finished 2001 A Space Odyssey, and they used the same set, I think it's in London, and they filmed the moon landing, and he admitted to doing it to his wife. He's now dead, and you know, he died right when he was about to release this Eyes Wide Shut, and he did The Shining, which there's clips of that point to the false moon landing. If you look at all these things, and the movie Eyes Wide Shut really points to the Illuminati and what they do. You know, brothers and sisters, I usually don't get into this stuff. I usually do straight up preaching and stuff. But I see that lots of people on the internet are trying to do some of this stuff, but they always keep it on the shallow end, you know. And for me, I love to go on off, you know, go to the upper end of the, or the deep end of the pool as far as we can go. And, you know, sometimes people get left behind. And that's why I would say, thank the Lord that the Google is still working. You can use it. Anything that we say in these videos, brothers and sisters, you know, and that's what I do. Hey, that's how I learned before, you know, and I still, sometimes there'll be somebody who'll say something, I don't know what it is, I'll immediately, while I'm listening to them, I'll just open up another page and Google that word. And then if it's really interesting, I'll stop the video, go research what they said. And you know, and then the thing that, you know, I don't let it discourage me anymore like I did when I started. There's always those low information people are who don't obey the Bible that says, you know, to be quick to listen and slow to speak. They'll hear somebody say something that they think is not right, and they'll immediately start commenting and trolling on the video and just babbling, and they don't even know the topic. So one of the best things that we can all do, as especially if you're a Christian, is to be humble. You know, and just say to yourself, you know, I don't know everything, and maybe somebody knows something I don't know. And so what I need to do before I would make a comment, I need to make sure that I've studied it out myself and look for myself. That's what I'm talking about. Let's be truth seekers. Let's be honest. Let's be willing to not, as I say about Christianity all the time, those of you who watch my videos, God has no grandchildren. And, you know, that's the biggest problem we have here in the Bible Belt, or even in all of America, but particularly here in the Bible Belt where Brother Sid and I are from. You know, it's a big Christian tradition here. So when you walk down the street, there's lots of people, they're not saved, but maybe their grandma is. And so you ask them, oh, yeah, I'm a Baptist. Yeah, I'm a Baptist. I went to there with my grandma when I was a kid or whatever. But they've got like a secondhand faith. They say they know about Jesus because their grandma said, oh, we're Baptist. But they don't really know Jesus themselves. They didn't seek, knock, and ask and find him. And so the same thing is true, brothers and sisters. That's what I'm trying to say. Just like with the Lord himself or any topic, seek, ask, and knock. And in these last days, you know, instead of being negative about it, let's be positive like what we're saying. Look, the internet is available. Let's exploit the internet. Let's exploit everything that the man has put out there to put out his agenda. And pornography and all those things, let's exploit what's out there till we can get to the root of what the truth is. And that's what I'm trying to say. The Bible is insinuating that the earth is flat and immovable. There's many, many, many more Bible verses, brothers and sisters. And I will say this, Google it yourself. Go look it up. You know, people ask me all the time, what does it say? Well, Google it. Go ahead.
Let me inject this. If you Google flat earth, just flat earth, you bring up 20,800,000 results.
Whoa.
Just by that many things have been brought up about the flat earth. So 20 million questions or concerns or theories or there, you know, it's not like three people. It's lots of people are asking questions.
Right.
And there's, you know, and I'm not promoting anybody, but you know, there's a guy, Eric Dubay, and I don't promote him at all, but he did get some stuff from Matthew Boylan. If you know anything about NASA, Matthew Boylan did some graphic work for NASA, and he saw some things and spoke out about the flat Earth and the, you know, and how they through some of these graphics that you see and some of these pictures they purport to you as fact. And they make some pretty interesting claims that you can research and look at for yourself. Make your own decision, like Brother Patrick is saying. We're not here to tell you what is or what isn't. It's just, if that many people are seeking the truth, I'm just one of them. Brother Patrick's one of them, and there are many, many in the community of people who look for truth in all things, and this is just one big, grand thing that I'm not convinced that it's flat, but I'm not convinced that it's a ball hurling through space either, and that I'm insignificant in all this, because I think God is very significant, and I believe I'm very significant to God. And I think if everybody knew that God created this, and it was a domed facility, so to speak, on its pillars, as the Bible speaks of, sitting here immovable, as Brother Patrick has told you, everybody's mindset's going to change pretty quick about how significant you are or insignificant you are versus a scientific view of, hey, forget about it. You know, live, drink, you know, eat, you know, party on, Garth. You know,
eat, drink, and be merry. That's right. That's right. Amen. You know, let me give a few more Bible verses. I just want to, Isaiah 11:12, Revelation 7:1, Job 38:13, Jeremiah 16:19, Daniel 4:11, Matthew 4:8. That's just a few more. There's many, many more. They don't necessarily say that the earth is flat. Some of them do seem to say that. It talks about the four corners of the earth, and some are not so direct. But anyway, brothers and sisters, there's so many different points we can get into. There's also the UN map. The on the UN flag and the USGS, go look it up if you don't know what it is. The USGS uses a map that is a flat earth. The UN flag, of course, has the flat earth map on it. And that map was actually designed by a Persian scientist about 1,000 years ago, a Persian astronomer. I can't think of his name off the top of my head. You can Google that. Now, why would the U.S. Geological Survey and the UN use a map that's over 1,000 years old, that before any modern technology, that was designed by a Persian astronomer? Maybe because it's accurate. I don't know. I mean, you know, it would make sense. They wouldn't use one that was totally inaccurate, I wouldn't think.
Well, I know if Antarctica is a continent, why is it on the UN map?
Right.
Why is there just an outer edge on the UN map? And if you look at the UN map, it has 33 sections in it. Wow, 33.
Right.
Go imagine that. And it has four bands. And if you look at a flat earth model where the sun and the moon move, the sun moves in and the sun moves out on a flat earth, and that's what creates the seasons. So there are a lot of questions you can come up with, but a lot of answers are out there that you can find of how this works in a flat earth. I know it's kind of mind-boggling. Whoa, the earth isn't round? And it is round. The Bible verse, and I know Brother Patrick knows this better than I, you know, it says that God etched a circle. And so it is round, but I don't believe it's a ball.
It could be a disc, like a disc.
I believe it's a disc.
Well, you know, that's right. We're not 100% sure on this. We haven't been to space ourselves. But, you know, the ancient Egyptians, they worshipped that winged disc. You know, the winged disc. If you go into the Washington Monument, you know, guys, the Lord has led me to do videos on all this. The phallic symbol there from ancient Egypt that they built as a monument to President George Washington. Inside that, when you start to get into the elevator, above the elevator entrance is the Egyptian winged disc. And that's really what they worship, that winged disc, which a lot of people believe it's, you know, that Nerubu, or they believe it's, you know, this dog star Sirius, or the sun. You know, these are the different levels of initiation into these ancient mystery religions, or it means all of those things. And I don't want to get off on a tangent of talking about the, you know, I've done videos in the past. If you look on my channel, I love to talk about it, because the Lord has had me studied about the, you know, what's the purpose of the obelisk and then the dome on top of the Capitol building there. But brothers and sisters, this is the point. Things are never as they seem. You know what we see with our fallen world and our fallen eyes and our fallen ears, what the devil's people are telling us. As Brother Sid mentioned about NASA. You know, NASA, for one thing, just like the Federal Reserve, this is another thing, another topic we could do another day. The Federal Reserve, as they say, is about as Federal Express. And NASA is actually not a part of the government. Even though it's ran as part of the government, it's actually a private company also. And it's actually started with Nazi scientists. It was what they call Operation Paperclip. And so all of the Nazis with Hitler, if you go look at this, you'll look at Himmler and Hitler and all those guys. They were occultists. You know, Hitler tried to get the spear of destiny. You can look that up. That's supposed to be the spear that pierced the side of Christ. It's there, supposed to be in Austria. It was held by the Austria-Hungary Empire before. So these Nazis were occultists. And this, I'm trying to think of how to say this name. I think it's the Theon or Thuth Society. It goes back to ancient Egypt. Also, same stuff. The Aryans and the ancient Egyptians, the Nephilim, all these things are all interconnected, brothers and sisters. Those people, Von Braun, who we got, you know, the father of the American space program, was a Nazi. All of those people were. They were, you know, occultists, wicked people, you know, brothers and sisters. And I just want to say this, too. You want to know why they want to go to Mars? Why do they have the Mars rovers? I made videos a long time about this. Because in their occult belief, and this is the bottom line, I'll tell you the short answer. Lucifer's abode before the fall was on Mars. And that's what it was. And I've done videos about it, and I think I might have wrote about it in the book. But anyway, that's why they always want to go to Mars. And that's all interconnected to the rise of the Antichrist and all these things. So all the things that NASA is selling us is to achieve their occultic goals. And everything they tell us is perverted and a lie and twisted to get more money. You know, just like the Cold War was exaggerated to raise more funds. Oh, the Russians are coming to get us. The Russians are coming to get us. Of course, it was all pumped up, even though, of course, we have our enemies militarily. But they pumped all those things up, brothers and sisters. The space race, everything was pumped up for propaganda, for funding. The military-industrial complex, all these things. Wake up, brothers and sisters. President Kennedy was killed by a conspiracy because he tried to stop all some of these things. Even though he wasn't a Christian, even though he wasn't a super moral guy, he was a free thinker outside the man's system, the Illuminati's brainwashing system. And it's so sad to see so many Christians who are bound up in all of this matrix that we live in, all of these lies upon lies.
That's the thing. If they lie to you about the simple things, do they not lie to you about the grander things?
Right, right. In
the late 50s, when Admiral Byrd went to Antarctica,
right,
and he came back and did that interview on TV, you can look that up, where he talks about there's great expanses of land, there's great resources, and now there's a treaty between every nation on Earth that no one can go to Antarctica and get any of those resources. There was coal, there was oil. He talked about all these wonderful things that could last for decades upon decades. But yet now every nation must sign an agreement that you cannot go, you cannot explore, you cannot go to the South Pole.
Right.
And do any research, you can't do any exploration. No private citizen, every country on Earth must sign that agreement. Ladies and gentlemen, I submit that as the number one fact. Anything the governments of the world are trying to cover up has to be greater than the small lies they tell us. It's the grand lie they're telling us.
Right. I agree, Brother Sid. And that's what I say. I'm not convinced 100% either way. And Brother Sid, we talked about, he's not either. But the point is, we know that we're taking anything that the government tells us with more than a grain of salt. With a highly doubtful, you know, the odds of against what they tell me being true, you know, is 90% that it's not true. Now, I just want to say this, too. Now, there's lots of people who have studied in the universities. Now, I took a lot of different higher level maths and stuff, okay, but I'm not any kind of an expert. But I've taken lots of different statistics and some physics and quantum mechanics and physics and chemistry and stuff that I took at University of Maryland. Just to put that out there, because maybe some non-Christians are watching this and they have this, this judgmental prejudging Christians that they're all ignorant and stupid. And there's lots of scientists who are Christians who believe in creation and all those things. So let me. I wanted to make a. I'm changing tracks here as it's just coming in my mindset. Let me say this for another thing. The Bible clearly teaches that the creation is about 6 to 10,000 years old. Okay, so right now, based off of that, all the science stuff that they're telling us is that the creation or the earth is spontaneous and it's billions of years old. So right there, either the Bible is wrong or they're wrong, even on that point. And what a lot of Christians have done, instead of standing up for instead of saying, I know what the Bible says and therefore I'm going to search out truth to show that the Bible is right. Instead of doing that, they just stick their head in their sand. Or they say, well, yeah, the scientists said we're stupid, so we must be stupid. You know, they don't take a stand and say, well, I know what the Bible says, so it must be right. Let's go see. And so I want to recommend somebody to you, Dr. Carl Ball. That's B-A-U-G-H. He has this creation in the 21st century. And he used to have a TV show when I first came back to the Lord. And it used to be on TBN once a week. And you could probably find it on YouTube or somewhere. And he would have all these different scientists. I mean, scientists from every field you could think of. Geology, astrophysics, whatever. Who were Christians. And they would explain, how to look at science. Because, let me say that, what I'm trying to say about those of you who, because I know I've talked to a few Christians who tried to tell me about the mathematics that prove that the earth is round and all this. See, this is what I'm saying. You are in a paradigm, just a different paradigm. You're just in another sandbox, and you're not breaking free of the sandbox that you're in. You're still thinking within a system that somebody gave you. In other words, a lot of the mathematical constants and formulas you've been given have been told to you also. You know, you haven't individually proven that those mathematical constants are true. And number two, just because a mathematical constant is true, doesn't make another mathematical equation false. So they're not mutually exclusive, as they say. So there are many other, and let me recommend another thing to research. If you really want to research the opening up to truth here, there's a guy named Carl Monk. And in the 1990s, he did a whole series of videos of, and he's a mathematician, but he was retired from the Navy, and he did all this research on the pyramids and the ancient Mayan ruins, and he was looking at how they're all interconnected. All the ancient monolithical sites are all interconnected, and they had things in common. And so what they had in common was a whole different set of constants. And when I say constants, I mean like the speed of light and all that. And pi, as an example, pi. Then all these constants that we don't even know about today. And what they were actually doing, of course, those were people that were under the influence of the Nephilim who were doing these different things. And since God had confounded the languages at the Tower of Babel, the language that they use is math and symbolism. And Sid, just give me another second here. While my mind's in this groove, that all of the things of the pyramids and the Sphinx and the obelisk and all those ancient sites, that's what I'm saying. God confounded their languages, and so they communicate through secret symbols, like we're talking about the map on the UN. They're communicating to each other that this is the right map. So because we have this language barrier that God set up, they have to communicate through symbols, secret symbols and all that, like the snake on the UN map, what we're talking about, all these things, to communicate these hidden truths that Lucifer gave his people, the Nephilim, his children, and all of that he gave them, that's this hidden wisdom. That's what all the mystery religions did in the past, and that's what mystery religions do today, like the Masons and all that. What they do is they initiate you, and as the more you will submit to worshiping Lucifer, the more of this hidden wisdom they will give you. Now, as I say, that hidden wisdom actually came from God, but it was just a piece of God's wisdom that Lucifer knew about and Lucifer shared with people that God didn't authorize humans to know about. And that's why we get all these breakthroughs in technology of NASA and a breakthrough in technology with nuclear bombs and all that. This is those kind of things that we see that's the influence of the evil dark forces and mystery religions channeling demons and Satan and all those things. That's what these things are pouring into our world through these vessels, these stargates of wickedness. Like the CERN and all that, brothers and sisters. But there is a truth under there that they know about that they're keeping from the average people, because as Brother Sid said, the whole point is the devil wants you to think you're insignificant, and then the earth is insignificant and we're nothing. The creation is nothing. There's no creation. It's been here for billions of years and we're just stardust, and we're just insignificant fluke and freak of evolution. All right, Brother Sid, I've been rambling on there now. I'll let you get back to the facts.
You know, I think I look at the point starting from Genesis, you know, in Genesis 1:7, where it talks about, and God made the firmament and divided the waters which were under the firmament from the waters which were above the firmament.
Right.
And it was so.
Right.
A lot of people talk about the firmament, and you know, a lot of people say, you know, in the beginning there were water and it was kind of a vapor, a kind of a greenhouse effect, and there was water underneath.
Right.
And then some people subscribe to the position that the firmament is somewhat of a barrier between the earth and the heavens above, which also, you know, contain water. One episode of The Simpsons, which you not can't use that, of course, predictive programming. Yeah, they do it through all kinds of TV, you know, so they show the dome several times. One time a baseball hit, cracked the dome, water poured down onto the field. So Einstein said he wasn't necessarily right about his theories about ether, which, you know, they're looking for the God particle and dark matter now in CERN, which could be the same thing that we're talking about. So, you know, open your mind. It's a big world out there, and there are a lot of things that you can at least research for yourself. And I'm going to give you this one guy, which, you know, he's a little controversial, but he has the flat earth clues. Some of you may have heard of that, and there's some very simple explanations of the flat earth. If you want to check into it, his YouTube channel is Mark Sargent, MarkSargent, one word. And he has like maybe 10 or 11, I think, flat earth clues, little short videos that explain some of the mapping of water, different things. They're simplistic. Some people go, well, he's a shill, you know, and everybody on YouTube's a shill. So, you know, it's take everything with a grain of salt. Look for yourself. Think for yourself. Don't believe me. Don't believe Brother Patrick, except about the Bible, man.
Right.
You know,
yeah.
Think for yourself. Make your own decision. You don't have to believe the earth is flat. You don't have to believe the earth is a disc. You don't have to believe it's a ball. You can believe it's a
cube.
it's a paper plate. I don't know. But think about it. Look at it. Don't always. We can't believe what we've been. What the government has brought us to believe that, you know, they push the New World Order, the one world government, and they can't get that unless they program you. So, you
right.
know, your programming's been in effect for all your life.
Right.
And it's going on today, and it's going to continue till they get what they want.
You know, there's a brother that watches my videos, and I didn't mention his name to you because I don't know if you've seen him. He's commented on my video several times, and I just happened to found a video about the flat earth, and he's the one who did it. Brother Thrive and Survive. Have you watched any of his stuff? He's a Christian.
Yeah. But,
yeah, I don't.
You know, he tries to be, the only thing about him, he tries to be somewhat controversial, and you know, it's my way or no way. It's the only thing I have against him. And
okay.
I don't think that. You know, I don't presume to tell you what to do, and I don't expect someone else on here on YouTube, especially,
right.
to tell me what to do. Nobody's a brain surgeon on YouTube.
Right. Yeah, right about that.
And I don't know anybody on, you know, the only people on the NASA channel, that's a joke on YouTube, you know. So
right, right.
So I don't know of anybody, you know, that's really can give me a great answer on that. So, you know, he's put up some stuff, and he's the one who wants to send a balloon up, and he was trying to get money to send a weather balloon up and take some pictures.
Okay.
So, yeah, I mean, he's got some stuff that's decent. Again, you know, look at it, you know, from your open eyes, your open mind, and make a decision on it for yourself.
Yeah. Yeah, that's what people need. That's what we're trying to get at. People need. We just touched on a few little points, brothers and sisters. Very few little points here about it. We didn't
even.
We've
been going 45
to.
Minutes, and we haven't really made a solid point, other than you know, that it's something you should look at.
Right. You know, because I mentioned about the gravity, and then also there's so many different points. You just want to hit a few quick ones, like when you look at the horizon. If you went to the beach and looked out at a ship. And I saw somebody who is against the flat Earth, and he was saying he's supposed to be a mathematician guy in England, but he's really pretty much of a jerk. But he was saying that by his calculations, and I don't know how true it is from trigonometry and calculus, that the eyesight that you can see is 5.2 kilometers out to the horizon, and then if you're 2 meters tall, 6 feet. When you look, you can actually see, a gap of 4 meters from your height to 2 meters below the horizon. In other words, there's a 4 meter gap that you could see at that 5.2 kilometers. So in other words, if something was 2 meters below the horizon, your ability to distinguish between 2 meters below and 2 meters above the horizon at that distance, you wouldn't be able to tell the difference at that distance. But that's what he was claiming, and he had some calculation on that. But
well, let me point out. Yeah. Here's the thing: everybody's going to say, "I've been in an airplane and I've seen the curvature of the Earth," and I'm going to tell you, "No, you haven't. You have seen a round bubbled window that has to be round to accept the pressure in there. It's a curved window. The pictures from NASA are taken through a round window.
Fish
if
eye,
they were taken
yeah.
through a square window." The Earth would be square. Fisheye lens are used just about exclusively to take pictures, and they present a curve. If you go and research yourself, you'll see that from any altitude that can be calculated up, looking out on the horizon, it's flat. It doesn't matter how high you go. If you look through a standard lens through your eyes or through a standard lens, you know, GoPros, especially the newer cameras, they say GoPro put the curve back in the Earth. Because they're all fisheye lens, so that's how they, you know, things. Your eyes can be very tricked very easily.
Well, what about the? I already know the answer. I'm asking you, Sid, just for convenience here. What about the pictures that the NASA has taken from space? You know, the moon, the Earth from the moon, and all that stuff.
Well, excuse me. I've seen some things about that, and they look pretty photoshopped. You can Google that, the NASA images from the moon photoshop. You can see the cut, you can see the cut and paste in them when people change the lighting on them.
Yeah.
You know, if the moon's a quarter size of the Earth and they're on the moon shooting the Earth, shouldn't the Earth look a little bigger in those pictures?
Right.
It's just a little teeny blue marble off in the distance somewhere.
Right, right.
And it should be a big, pretty big ball if you're on the moon looking down on something four times as big as the moon.
Right, right. It should be four times as big in the sky. In other words, if I see a full moon on the Earth and then I went to the moon, the Earth should be four times as big
yeah,
in the
so
sky.
If you've seen the full side of the Earth, then it should be four times as big.
Right.
You know, and how come the moon, we talked about this earlier, how come you can only see one side of the moon ever? That it's so synchronized with the Earth, no matter where you go on the Earth, you can't get on one side and see something else or on this side and see a different. It's always one side. So how is it only one side?
Yeah, we don't see it rotating or nothing. We don't see the moon rotating.
They put up a picture recently. NASA released a picture of the backside of the moon, supposedly from a million miles away, that they have a camera out there. And it's pretty...
well, you know, they pass off a lot of animation as real, as an example.
Right.
How did they film... If you go look at the moon landing footage... There's film from the moon surface of the lunar module taking off, you know, and landing. How did they get that? Or they even have, I remember when I was a kid when they had those Viking, I believe it was, satellites that went way out to the end of the universe. They had pictures of the satellite from behind. I mean, how did they get behind it, like 100 miles behind it or 50 miles behind it, to take a picture of it if there was only one satellite? That's what I can't figure out, you know? It's obviously it's all animation that they're showing.
Yeah, that goes back to some of the graphics by that gentleman Matthew whatever that I talked about earlier in the beginning. That you know that they make all these great you know, like you say, animation, and they pass it off as pictures of from space. Yeah, until like a couple weeks ago, they had only released one official picture of the Earth since 1972.
Right.
As many times we've been to the moon, as many satellites as they're up there, as many things ever. One picture of the Earth from space, one since 1972.
Yeah, and they said, I saw someone that did something on that, and they were showing how the cloud formations were exactly the same all over it, and they were too lazy to even make new. When they photoshopped it, they didn't even use different cloud formations. There's several of them that's just a copy. They copied and pasted so much, and it was kind of like Obama's birth certificate. You know, it was a low grade job for a high paid got paid high to do a job, and they did a low grade.
That's kind of the pictures from the moon. That's how they break down under those kind of scrutiny. They look very photoshopped when you change the lighting and the textures and all the different things that you can do now. And that's why it's so hard for them to get away with stuff. See, it's been easy for them to fake this forever because you didn't have the ability you have now to go out and research this yourself, break this down in Photoshop yourself, do a lot of these things yourself. Up until you had the internet, you had to rely on the evening news to get your news. That was kind of the only way you knew what was going on, and you only knew what they told you.
Right.
And obviously we've learned that that's not necessarily always true. So.
Right. Like I said, I think that in the post-World War II era, I guess the Kennedy assassination was such a pivotal point. I wrote about that in the book, you know, the 60s being such a pivotal thing. President Eisenhower, you know, American President Eisenhower, he warned the nation when he was going out of office in 1960. He said that, you know, beware of the military-industrial complex. He tried to hint around about all the things they're doing. And then even President Kennedy, before they killed him, he had made a speech about all these conspiracies and stuff. You can find that on the internet. And I just wanted to add, while I was thinking about it, you can go Google Jelly Donut on Mars if you want to see the NASA trying to explain something that's obviously maybe somebody at NASA was trying to get the truth out, and they planted a little something there in front of the rover that wasn't there the day before. It looks like
you can also Google rodent on Mars, and there's a clear furry gerbil or you know, rat, or there's something there, and it's pretty clear. I'd Google that and check that out too. That's on Mars too.
Yeah, well, you know, there's a guy, and he's just he's way off of that. He used to be the science advisor for CBS News. And for Walter Cronkite, and I forgot his name now, he's done all this stuff about, you know, saying about the moon landing and all this stuff. But he says that we went there. He's got all these wacky ideas. I'm trying to think of his name, if you can think of him. He's got lots of ideas. But anyway, he had done a video, and he showed the moon landing, and there's these, it looks like glass buildings or something in the background. And then this guy, he's one of these guys who's so insane. He said something like, oh, there's aliens living in glass buildings on the moon from these photos from the moon landing. I'm trying to think of his name, and you'll know his name when I say it. But what he's really looking at, those other people that have researched it with Stanley Kubrick's work, it's actually from the 2001 Space Odyssey studio where they filmed the movie 2001. Same place they filmed the moon landing, according to the widow of Stanley Kubrick. When they did the beginning of that movie, there's like the monkeys, and then there's like this glass pyramid in the background and all that. The opening scene of 2001 Space Odyssey. They had made that background with these, not blue screen, this was before blue screen. And in that screens they use, there's a line like every so many feet. And you can see in that movie, and then also there's someone who's done a film of this showing the moon landing where you can see those same parallel lines of that blue screen curtain. But this was pre-blue screen. They called it something else. Same thing where you put these images in the background. And that's what you can see. But this guy, what is his name? It's not Hoven. What's his name? I'm drawing a blank right now. Anyway, he's thinking that, you know, these whole wacky ideas about the You know, the astronauts are keeping it a secret that there's aliens living in glass towers on the moon. As a,
I know that none of the astronauts would swear on a Bible that they went to the moon.
I saw that too.
Yeah, you can Google that.
You can definitely
You can Google the movie Room 237. That's a movie about some of Stanley Kubrick stuff. They say that was the room, the setting where the actual moon landing was filmed in studio room 237. So lots of things. We're giving you lots of information, lots of crumbs here that you can pick up and run with and try to, you know, research this out. Maybe you can bring some stuff to us. So it would be great to learn more from everybody. You know, it's a community of people looking for the truth, not just like me or Brother Patrick. We should all be looking for the truth and helping each other, not breaking down each other. Same thing as Christians. You know, we should do that in our life, in everything that we do. So I believe in truth seeking, or, you know, whether you're seeking, you know, the Lord Jesus, or if you're seeking the, you know, what's the shape of the earth. We should all help each other and chip in and get everybody to, you know, to the truth.
Amen, brother. Amen. You're absolutely right about that. I was just trying to look up that guy's name. I can't think of it. Who did that? What I referenced to? He did about the face on Mars. And he's the first one really to show about the face on Mars before. And he really got into all these conspiracy theories. But he believes we landed on the moon, but there's aliens living there from this. I told you the anomalies in the video footage. You know, there's lots of things. You can go watch these things yourself. Like there's different sources of lighting. The videos from the moon landing, there's different sources of lighting. So it is one, the shadows cross instead of being parallel, which they should be under the light of the sun. You never have shadows coming from different directions unless you have more than one source of light. These kind of things about the moon landing that I just mentioned. But anyway, brothers and sisters, as Brother Sid said, we're planning to do a whole series on this. We can do one on 9/11 too, seeking the truth of how buildings fall at free fall speed, all the different things that connect back to the New World Order and how this connects to Christians not being afraid of confronting every issue. And that's the thing about it. You talk about evolution, talking about the earth being billions of years old and all these things. We have to confront and be open-minded to discuss any topic, brothers and sisters. We can't surrender any truth to the enemy. Because as we're trying to say, if you get people to believe all of these lies, then later on, then, you know, it's like, well, what it is, the Bible must not be true. If it's billions of years old and there's been evolution and all these things that the government tells us, what the world is telling us, then how can the Bible also be true? So we can't be afraid. Go ahead.
I believe you have to stand up for the Bible. The point is, nothing in the Bible has ever been disproven. Ever.
Right, right.
So, you know, you have to believe it all because all of it has to be true because it just can't be disproven. Just like evolution, though, you have to understand. It's just a theory. The ball earth. It's just what you're told. You know? So I'm gonna stand with the Bible. I'm just gonna hang on to that. I'm just gonna roll with what it says. I'm gonna stand with that to the very end. I think you taught me something one time, as Brother Patrick said in the beginning. We've been talking together, met many, many times. We've talked about the Lord a lot, and I think Brother Patrick said it best one time. When you get to the point in your life where you cannot be moved. You cannot be moved, no matter what they bring, no matter what they say, no matter what they do. You cannot be moved. That's where you need to get to. It'll bring a peace to you that is, just like the Bible says, beyond comprehension. It's great. It's wonderful. Just know you can't be moved.
Amen, Brother Sid. You're absolutely right about that. We have to be immovable. Like I said, it's so funny. And that guy's name is Richard C. Hoagland, just to put it out there, FYI. Who did this? Who talked about the aliens on the moon, which is a wrong thing there? What's going on? But there are demons in outer space, and angels pass through the second heaven. Outer space that we're talking about is the second heaven. angels and fallen angels and demons. And when people die, we pass through that area. So when people see UFOs, they could be seeing demons, they could be seeing angels, and they could be seeing fallen angels. They could be seeing someone passing to heaven. And in another video, I'll explain the difference between demons and fallen angels. But they are different. I put that out there just to intrigue you. What's the difference? I asked you that. What Brother Sid is saying is right. We have to know that by his stripes we are healed. You know, that he, those who believe on him will not perish but have everlasting life. If we can't believe those, all the things that the Bible says, how can we believe in heaven? You know, how can we believe that when you die you go to heaven? And you can't believe things that are right here on in front of us, right in front of us. But yet we're saying, oh, I believe that, you know, in heaven. I believe all these things I've never even seen before. So, brothers and sisters, you have to have as Brother Sid said, an immovable, unshakable faith in God and in his word. You know, that's what amazes me, too. I want to say this. There's a brother, you know, who started, and Brother Sid knows who I'm talking about. We talked about this. Started challenging the word of God, saying that, well, the Bible that we have today is not the right Bible. And because him and his son had done some research and started saying that the Bible we got is not right. Well, let me tell you something. That is not true. And I want to say this too. If you want to find out about the reliability of the Bible, that it's the text that we have today is the same text they had 2,000 years ago, do not listen to somebody on YouTube who is just, you know, a part-time guy on it. Like we're talking about the earth. We're given what we've seen in research, and as Sid has said, we're by no means experts on the topic. Okay, we're throwing out there what we've seen, but there are people who are doctors of theology, and as a matter of fact, like Randall Price, Dr. Randall Price is a great example. He is a doctor of Middle Eastern ancient religions and customs and languages, and he's written many books. I used to read a bunch of his books. About the Temple Mount and where the temple was and all this stuff. Guy's an expert and in that topic. And that's the kind of people you go to. And if you'll find out from these experts who know the Dead Sea Scrolls and all these things, you'll find out that the Bible we have today is the same one they had back then. Or the Dead Sea Scrolls, you're talking about the Old Testament. The same thing they had then is what we have now. We have over 1,500 copies of the New Testament written before about 200 or 250 A.D. So we have the same Bible that they had then. Assuredly. And the people to ask are manuscript experts and professors, not people from YouTube. So the word of God is reliable and it's sharper than a two-edged sword, you know, dividing asunder the thoughts and intents of the heart, Hebrews 4:12. And you have to have faith in the word. Like I said, go research that the same word we have today is the same one they had 2,000 years ago. And then as you read it, take it as truth. It's not written as a scientific explanation. It's written as truth. So if the Bible says the sky was green, then the color we're calling blue is actually green, but that's not the case. But you see what I'm saying. What we have been told in this world is just the ideas of man, based off of theories and ideas, pie in the sky things that have been developed into disciplines. Some are based in fact and some are not, brothers and sisters. That's what we're trying to say. Like evolution is an example. Way out there and way wrong. Evolution is not true. But it's accepted in the scientific community by most scientists as true, except for those who believe in intelligent design. That's a whole other video we could do. I don't know if Brother Sid has had time to research that stuff, intelligent design. That's a whole other video.
Well, we get into intelligent design versus evolution. So, yeah, that's something we could certainly touch on.
We could do a video.
We rambled on about an hour here. it's hard enough to get anybody to watch a five-minute video, much less a hour video and get anything from it.
Right.
I just wanted to add one thing here at the end. I know Brother Patrick always puts his email address under every video. I'm going to give you mine because, you know, I don't want to be out here and you not be able to get a hold of me. So I'm going to give it. It's really simple. It's Sydney, S-I-D-N-E-Y, at churchfirstborn, one word, churchfirstborn.com. I'm a single guy. Shoot me a line. I'll get back. I'm just like Patrick. I'll get back to you. I'll find some way to answer whatever it is that you might want to ask me. So I'll put that out there. So I don't want to offer myself up in anonymity. I want to be able to, interact with you if you have a question or a concern.
Well, Brother Sid, I asked you also, maybe you could put in the comments, put your email down there too, on down through there.
That was my email, brother.
No, I mean, put it in the comments at the bottom, in the bottom. And then if people are asking questions, of course, you can come on there and answer them too. People can see the answers and questions sometimes maybe even under this video. Now, if you're seeing it in the future, there'll be some questions and answers at the bottom from myself or Brother Sid. Answer them here on so everybody can see them too on here.
And we don't know every answer.
No, we don't. We're not experts on the topic. I totally agree. But we're trying to get to the truth. That's the whole point. And that's the whole point of this whole thing for me. It's not about if the earth is flat or round, because ultimately it don't really matter to me what the shape of the earth is. The point is I'm not bound by what I've been told by the government or by school in the earth. I'm not bound by those things. My mind is open to truth and know God better and know His creation as best as I can, and always be open to learn something that I don't know. So it's a matter of humility. And then there's lots of people that are afraid. They just don't want to fool with it. Well, that's fine too. If you don't have time and don't want to fool with it, that's also something. But let's be open.
And don't bash people if you're not willing to spend the time and look at some of this yourself. Just don't go, oh, you're crazy. Well, okay.
Well, we know we're crazy. What does that got to do with the flat earth?
Real simple. Just go, you're crazy, and just leave it at that. Because I already know I am.
We're already crazy, but that might not. That has no connection to whether the earth is flat or round.
Exactly.
Yeah. Well,
that doesn't weigh in.
Well, Brother Sid and I, when we talk, brothers and sisters, we have a lot of, we've been pretty serious. Normally when we talk, we're having a whole lot more entertainment value to it. And I was hoping to do that on this video. We didn't really get to it, but maybe.
Well, sometimes you got to be serious. Sometimes things are serious. And, in the first video, we should just, tell people that, the truth is out there if you're willing to, willing to look all kinds of things. And maybe you guys could post a comment and say what you'd like to hear about the government's doing, or the New World Order, or our conspiracies that were created by the government for you, and if there's a conspiracy that you'd like to hear us talk on the topic, if we know something that some good relevant information, we'd be glad to help you out, I think.
Yeah, that's true. I like to look at these different topics, and I've researched it extensively over the years, and before the internet. I used to look at all that stuff too, and then now with the internet, it's really so, you can cover a whole lot more material a whole lot faster without having to go to the library. And so it's really, it's nice. I think that's true. I think that we invite people to ask questions on any topic that they would like to hear covered. I think that's a great idea. And we can do it. We can link it back to the Bible and, the rise of the New World Order and all that. I think that's a great idea. And we should go with it. We should go with it. And I think there's the thing about it, Brother Sid, there's lots of people who, the Lord, Paul said to become all things to all people, and there are people who would get saved when they hear us talking about this, and God can use any of these truths to link people back to creation. Of course, that links them to God and the Bible, which, once you say, okay, well, creation must be true, then, of course, it leads you to the next logical step to, well, the Bible must be true, so let's look at the gospel. What does the Bible say? People could get saved. And that's what we want to do. And that's why I think people that watch this, God can use you. I have a brother who was an atheist, and now he's agnostic. He still didn't get saved yet, but he was a hardcore atheist. He believed in evolution and all that. But as I talked to him about these topics, he realized that evolution and all that stuff couldn't be true. And it just opened his mind up to the possibility that the Bible could be true. So he said, okay, I'm an agnostic now because I'm not sure.
I get a lot of information from someone who's agnostic. They used to be a hardcore Christian, then they were a hardcore atheist, and then they fell out and became an agnostic because they thought both sides were crazy. Right. And they present a lot of wonderful information on YouTube. So I don't get all my information from a Christian. I don't want to be bound that everything, we're not, we're looking at things from all perspectives, tying it back to the Bible, because right. We are Christians. But it doesn't mean we have to limit our information and what we get from, right. Everybody who's a Christian, because we're trying to, as Brother Patrick says, influence other people. So I don't see any wrong with gathering information from right. people who are presenting a view that has strong points that you can learn from.
Right. Right. That's what we're trying to do. Yeah, we can learn from lots of different people. And that's what I say. People are so dogmatic. And that's what hurts Christianity, people that are just so dogmatic. Like, I mean, that's why I made the video about, you know, we're supposed to occupy till the Lord comes. And I said, instead of hiding from what in America, they've made Halloween so big now. I said, instead of hiding from what they're doing, go out and take it over. Exploit it. Give out candy and put stickers on there that says, Bible verses and stuff, as I mentioned. I had several trolls. Well, not that many. Thank the Lord. Maybe five trolls who were just having a stroke fit about it. You know, that we're supposed to cut off the lights and hide in the house and all these things.
I'm not going to hide because those little children don't know any different. And being hateful to the little children doesn't solve the problem.
That's right. That ain't going to win nobody to Jesus.
That it's evil and satanic does not give us, a right to hide behind the door. We can't be closet Christians, people. That's the whole problem with Christians. Everybody wants to hide, and I'm saved, I'm good, I'm done. No, you're not done.
Selfish. That's what I'm saying.
You're in trouble. You're going to have to make that conversation with God when He rewinds your whole life. Remember, everything's, you're going to get to see it all because you're judged by your deeds, not to get in heaven, because that's a whole nother topic. But you're still going to get to see what right. you've done here on earth. So don't hide your talent. As you know, the Bible said, the one He comes back, and that's the one He chastised, the one who just hid his talent under the dirt and said, right. I wanted to make sure it was still here. It's not good enough.
Right.
You need to increase them.
Right. You need to get out and bear fruit. That's what Jesus said. You bear fruit for Him after you're saved. We're born unto, we're saved unto do good works, it says in Ephesians, not by works, but to do good works. And that's what I'm talking about. We're supposed to be out there and Peter said, to be ready to give an answer for the hope that lies within you. You're supposed to be prepared in season and out of season to respond to people, in any topic and be on it, about tying it back into the gospel. And so that's what we're trying to do. And that's why, we dove into the deep end. We didn't clown around with the shallow stuff. We dove right into the deep end here, Sid. We opened up a great debate. And
I think diving into the deep end is the best way to go. I mean, just, start out in the deep end. Maybe we can walk out later.
Maybe
we can head that way and walk out the shallow side.
That's right. Yeah, we can. But, it's just so funny. I'm sure there's people who, if I title this video, Is the Earth Flat? There's probably lots of non-believers that'll start watching this thing and get into it. But I'm not going to let people come on here trolling and arguing about, the finer points of the flat earth or the round earth. But I want it to be, a Christian discussion to lead to that,
I've seen a lot of some of the people who do flat earth stuff allow comments, and some people don't, obviously, so
right.
it could be I'm sure there's going to be some free-for-all under there, so,
got to play it by ear.
Be respectful. You're going to, a lot of you Christians who see Brother Patrick's videos all the time, there are probably going to be a lot of non-Christians, as he said, view this, and they may leave some ugly comments before Patrick can get them off, maybe, but, right. so, understand that, these people are, no matter how wild they react, maybe something strikes that nerve that brings them to the Lord. So
right, they're watching it. I see people all the time on Christian videos bashing the Christian video.
Yeah, usually the people that are the maddest are the people you'll get sooner or later.
Right, I mean, they're watching it. For some reason, they've been compelled to watch it by the Lord, and it's working on them somehow, in their heart. So that's what we want. That's what it's all about. Just like when I say, I have to say it all the time when I talk about the Antichrist. There's always a Christian who will put on there, well, I'm not looking for the Antichrist. I'm looking for the Lord. And I always have to remind people over and over again, the video is not necessarily just for you. there's non-believers who might see this and get saved. It's not all about you. It's about, reaching all people with the good news of Christ. That's what all the videos I do are about. to reach all kinds of people, and ultimately for them to get saved. That's the purpose.